Hello and welcome to the CloudWaitress video tutorial series. In this episode, I'm going to show you how to configure your various services that you offer to your customers. So to show you exactly what I mean, I'm going to hit the View Store button in my admin dashboard, and I'm going to take a look at my store page. Once that's done loading, if I start the ordering process, the first thing a customer needs to choose is what service they like: pickup, delivery, dine-in, or table bookings. So all the various rules around these services can be configured to match your particular business rules. So to do that, we'll go back to the admin dashboard. If you haven't already logged in, log in at admin.cloudwaitress.com and then select your restaurant. Then we're going to head to the settings page and we're going to go to the services tab. And under the services tab, you will find all the settings that allow you to configure those various services. And I'm going to take you through the process of all the settings available and we'll see how to configure that so it matches your business rules. At the time of making this tutorial, CloudWaitress allows you to accept four different types of orders. That is pickups, deliveries, dine-ins, and table bookings. A pickup is an order which a customer will come in-store to collect. A delivery is an order that you will deliver out to the customer's chosen address. A dine-in is an order that's accepted when the customer is actually in your restaurant and sitting down in your table. So it's a way for you to take orders from customers that are already seated. And finally, table bookings allow you to accept reservations and bookings in advance from the customer for a particular date and time. There are several common settings available for all the different service types. The most important thing is the ability to enable and disable certain services. Not every restaurant is going to accept pickups, deliveries, dine-ins, and table bookings. So if there's something you don't offer, say for instance in this case dine-ins, then we will select that. And there'll be an option that says dine-in enabled. We'll just simply check that to disable it and press save. And now when we open up our store page, if the customer goes to place an order, you can see the dine-in option is no longer available to choose from. For the purpose of this tutorial, I will enable all the different services because I'm going to take you through everything. The next thing we want to look at is the notes. Every different service has a note section. So for instance, even pickups has a note section over here. Whatever we type out here is going to be shown to the customer when they go to select that particular type of service. So if I say for pickup notes, please come in through the back entrance, and I save that form. Then if I go back to the store page, I refresh the page, and if I go to place an order as a customer when they select pickup, you can see that the note has come through here. An extremely important group of settings that you have to configure correctly are your order timing settings. The order timings control when your customers are able to place orders. So first, let's go take a look at the opening hours section to understand a bit more about how it works. We'll head to the admin dashboard and we'll go to system and we'll select the location section and scroll down to see our opening hours. Now your opening hours would have been entered in when you first created the restaurant. The very important thing to understand about the opening hours is customers can only place orders within this period of time. And what I mean by that is, if a customer is placing an order for immediate collection, that can only be done when your store is open. And if a customer is scheduling an order for a later date or time, then it has to be scheduled within your opening hours. Now, the order timing settings for each of the services allow you to have a bit more fine-grained control over the opening hours and the particular service itself. So if I scroll back up and I go to the services tab, let's say I select pickups. Now every different service has the order timings tab under it. If you select that, you can see all the order timing settings relating to that particular service. The first thing you might want to do is, you might want to enable or disable orders for immediate or later collection. So say for instance, I only wanted customers to schedule orders for a later date, and I didn't want them to place orders for immediate collection, then I could simply disable the setting that says enable immediate orders, press save. And if I go back to my store and refresh the page, let's say as a customer I try to place an order now, I select pickup, and I can see the option to order for right now, it says unavailable. The next thing we want to look at is there are a couple of other very important settings. Firstly, the order offset settings. So there's the first order offset and the last order offset. The best way to describe the order offsets is that it's a period of time in which when your store first opens or just before it closes where a customer is unable to place an order. So for instance, a very common scenario is that, say your restaurant closes at 10 p.m., you might accept the last order at 9:30. You do not want customers to place orders between 9:30 to 10 o'clock, which is a 30-minute window. So if you wanted to make that happen, in the last order offset, you would set it to 30 for 30 minutes. Now, by default, the first order offset and last order offset are set to 30, so you might want to change that depending on when your last and your first order can be placed relative to your opening hours. The next thing we can look at is the settings for later orders. The first thing is the maximum days ahead, which means that if the value is set to 7, which is the default value, then a customer can only schedule an order 7 days in advance. Then there is the time interval. The time interval is best described by showing you how it works. So right now it's set to 15, which is the default value. So as a customer, if I go to place an order for a later date or time, and I select a date, when I go to select a time, you can see all the time is in 15-minute increments. You probably want to keep this value between 15 to 30 so that the customer can schedule the order relatively close to exactly when they want it. And lastly, a very important setting is the order offset setting. The order offset setting controls what is the minimum amount of minutes from now that a customer is able to schedule a later order for. So by default, it's set to 30 minutes, and I'll explain exactly what this means. Say for instance, the customer wanted their order exactly 30 minutes from now. Instead of actually scheduling the order for that time, they can just order for immediate collection if it's probably going to take you around 30 minutes to make that order. So the order offset essentially is the period of time where the customer should be ordering for immediate collection instead of scheduling it for a later date or time. Now there's a very important fine point with the order offset, which is that if the order offset is set to 30, which is the default, then a customer must schedule an order at least 1 hour from now. And the reason is because you want to give the customer a 30-minute period to actually place the order, so that if they take the whole 30 minutes to place it, then there's still that 30-minute gap from when they can last place the order to when it's actually due. Now you can control the order timing settings for all the different services available if you go back to the settings page, and you can see each of the different services have their own order timings tab where you can edit the settings specific to that particular service. The custom hours allow you to set custom opening hours for different services individually. So by default, your opening hours for all your services will be taken from your general store opening hours. But say for instance, for deliveries, we had a different set of opening hours which were different to our normal store hours. You'd go to the delivery section, which we already have open, and then we'd select available hours. And over here, we can create a separate list of opening hours that apply just for this delivery service. And whatever you put over here is going to override your normal store hours. And you can configure this for each of the different services available if you have specific hours just for that service. The next group of settings we're going to take a look at are the estimated wait time and automated status settings. These settings allow you to streamline the management of your orders while also keeping your customers in the loop. So when your customer places a new order and they get their order receipt, if you've configured it correctly, they will get a good estimated wait time, and initially the order is going to start as unconfirmed. Now instead of you manually going through and updating all the order statuses, you can use these settings to automatically update the order status and inform your customer when the order is confirmed and when it's ready and when it's even on route for deliveries. So each of the different services has their own wait time and auto statuses tab, so you can edit the settings specific to that particular service. So under pickups, I can select wait times and auto statuses, and I can see there's a bunch of different settings available. On the top, you can enable or disable automated statuses for a particular status itself. And below that, you can control the amount of time it takes for the orders to move between all the statuses. So first, a very common thing that people want to do often is they want to automatically confirm new orders rather than having to manually do that for every single order. So if I wanted to automatically confirm new orders, I can enable the automated confirm status, and then in the fields below where it says time till confirm, I can set the value of 0, which means that the time from when the order was placed to when the order is confirmed. So if the value is 0, it means that the order is going to be instantly confirmed. Next, we can look at the time till ready, which means in this case for pickups, the time when the order is actually available for the customer to come in store and collect it and it's ready for pickup. So the time till ready and all the other following statuses are based on the times of the previous statuses as well. So what I mean by that is, say I set the time till ready to 25 minutes and say the time till confirm was 5 minutes, then the way the system would work is, it would give you 5 minutes to confirm the order and then another 25 minutes until it's actually ready. So for the customer, The actual time till ready will be 30 minutes from when the order is actually placed. And if I wanted to automatically update the ready status as well, I would go and check the enable automated status for the ready status box just up here. And lastly, we might want to automatically mark the order as complete over a particular period of time instead of doing that manually like the other statuses as well. So say I enable time till complete and I set a value of something a bit high like 200. Well, what that means is after several hours has passed once the order has been placed, it will automatically mark that order as complete. Now, this is useful because you might want to give a little bit of time before you actually complete the order, just in case there's something else that happens with the actual order, which is why we'd set the time till complete to something a little bit high. The next thing we're going to discuss is how the estimated wait times are calculated based off these times you've set over here. So with pickup orders, the estimated wait time is dependent on the time till confirm and the time till ready. So what that means is that, say the time till confirm is set to 5 and the time till ready is set to 25, then the total estimated wait time for when the customer can expect to come and collect the order will be 30 minutes, since it's 5 plus 25 over here. Now, in the event of delivery orders, say I close this and I go to the delivery section and I go to wait times and auto statuses, we'll see that the deliveries has another status, which is the on route status. The on route status says the order has left your store, it's with the delivery driver, and it's on the way to the customer's address. In the event of a delivery, the estimated wait time is based on the time till confirm, the time till ready, the time till on route, and the actual driving time from your store to the customer. So to give you an example, let's say I set 0 for automated and instant confirmations. I say 25 minutes till the order is actually going to be prepared in store, and then 5 minutes till it actually makes it out into the vehicle and it's on its way to the customer. And let's just say the actual customer's address is 10 minutes away from your store. What that means is the estimated wait time that they will receive is 0 plus 25 plus 5, so totally 30 minutes, plus the 10-minute driving time to actually get from the store to the customer. So the estimated wait time is going to be 40 minutes in total from when the customer placed the order. And just like that, you can give your customers very accurate estimated wait times for all your different order types. Next, we're going to take a look at the various delivery settings available. So if we scroll up, we're already in the delivery settings for the service. And if we go back to the start of the tabs and we start the general tab, the first important setting we're going to take a look at is the restrict delivery addresses setting. When your customer goes to place a delivery order and they start searching for the address, they're going to get a list of suggestions of potential addresses that they are referring to. If you set this to restrict delivery addresses to, say, just Australia, then your customer is only going to get suggestions of addresses just in Australia, and this is going to help cut down the noise of completely irrelevant suggestions in a different country. Next, the settings to avoid tolls and avoid highways. What this means is when the customer places a delivery order, we are going to calculate the driving time and the driving distance. Now, if you avoid tolls and highways and you tell your drivers to do so, enabling these settings will give a much more accurate driving time and driving distance. Next is the conditions tab. The conditions tab allows you to configure certain conditions that must be met before a delivery order is accepted. So the first is the minimum order amount, and it does exactly what you think it would, which is, for example, if I set it to 30, then it means that a customer must order at least $30 worth of items before the delivery can be made and they can check out. This is good to prevent low order values because you don't want to be driving somewhere and delivering an order that might just be $5, for example. Next is the max delivery distance and max driving time. So as I said before, the distance and the driving time are calculated for the delivery order, and if the distance and driving time exceeds this, then the order will be rejected. Now, this is very helpful in particular with the driving time because, say for instance, the customer is still within your delivery distance, but there's a big traffic jam, then Google is going to let us know that there's a traffic jam and the driving time might be 90 minutes, say, even though the distance is within store range, but the order will still be rejected because it doesn't meet the max driving time criteria. So you can configure these settings how you like, depending on how far away you're willing to accept orders. Then there are the delivery fee settings. The delivery fee is exactly what it says it is, which is it allows you to add a fee for every delivery order, specifically for the delivery itself. So by default, it's set to no delivery fee. If we wanted to have a fixed delivery fee, we'd press the fixed button and say we can have a $12 fee, fixed delivery. And next option is you can have a delivery fee that is based on the driving distance itself, which is the range option. So over here, I can create a few different pricing brackets. Say, for example, 0 to 5 kilometers, I want that to cost the customer $8. If the order is between 5 to 8 kilometers, I'm going to charge a $12 delivery fee. And finally, if the order is between 8 to 12 kilometers, say, I'm going to charge a $15 delivery fee, which is what this means over here. And last, there is the free delivery amount, which means that if the customer's cart total exceeds this value, then the delivery fee will be voided and the customer will be given free delivery. So say you want to encourage larger orders, we set a free delivery amount to 60. The customer orders more than $60 worth of items, they're going to get free delivery. Lastly is the delivery zones. So the delivery zones allow you to configure specific areas at which you will accept deliveries within. And whatever delivery zones you configure will overwrite your delivery condition settings and will overwrite your delivery fee settings, because you can set a particular fee for each of the zones. Now we'll cover how to actually create delivery zones in a separate tutorial video, but you can just read the instructions over here and follow them, and then come and upload your delivery zone file, and it's going to automatically map out your zones and only allow customers to order within that. The next thing we're going to take a look at is the dine-in table setting. So I will close the delivery settings over here and I'll open the dine-in section and I will head to the tables tab. So when a customer is placing an order from a table, they have to be able to select their table and then proceed with the order so that you also know where to send the actual order out to. So to give you an example, I will create three tables and I will give them a name of A, B, and C. And so when a customer comes to order, they'll be able to pick between table A, B, and C. Now to prevent spam orders, I can also add a table password. So say for table A, I add a password of 123. What this means is when a customer selects table A, they will be prompted to enter the table password, and only when they enter the password, then they can proceed with the actual order. So on the table, you probably want to have a stand that has the table name and the table password, so a customer is able to enter those details in and then proceed with their order. Now to make it even more streamlined for the customer, you can use this order URL over here. If the order URL is visited, then the order will automatically be configured to this particular table. The customer doesn't have to configure the order. They can straight away just add the items to their cart and check out easily. So this order URL ideally can be embedded in something such as a QR code or an NFC tag in your actual order stand. So a customer can visit your store and they can just simply scan the QR code on the table or tap their phone if it's NFC enabled. And it's going to straight away take them to the online store for them to place the order without having to configure anything. So if I save this and I copy this order URL and I paste it in my browser, we'll see that when the customer visits the store, there is no need to configure the order as you usually would with the book and order button at the top. It's already showing the cart. The customer can straight away add the item they want and they can check out without needing to configure anything. And the table is already set to table A. The last thing we're going to take a look at are the table booking settings. So we'll head back to the admin dashboard and we'll open up the table booking section. So the most important thing that you can really customize here is the ability to limit the number of people allowed in one particular booking. So we can do that by entering the limit number of people over here. So say I put a value of 10. When a customer goes to make the reservation, they have to enter how many people are going to be part of the reservation. And if that amount exceeds your limit, the number of people, then the customer will get a warning saying that we only allow a maximum of 10 people in one booking. Next is the booking timings, which you can click the tab booking timings over here. This is similar to the other service timings, but the big difference is because bookings can only be scheduled for later data time, you won't see the settings concerning the actual immediate orders, which is what you would have seen with the other services. The only settings available are the ones for scheduling bookings for later date and time. And lastly, you will also notice that over here there is no automated wait times or statuses available, because when we're talking about bookings, those things are not really too relevant, so those settings are not available for table bookings itself.